Welcome back to our Olympic special from a very sunny London. It's not widely known that all cities vying for the Olympics have to sign a massive contract before the winner is announced. There's a story going round that just before our next guest put pen to paper in 2005 to sign London up, he said jokingly, "Do I have any choice?" The reply was a firm no. So, 7 years on, had the Olympics turned out the way he wanted? I spoke with the former mayor of London, Ken Livingstone, at his home a short time ago, and surprisingly found he's not excited by the grand event that's about to unfold.
I have no interest in sport. I was the smallest boy in a school of 2,000. I was last in everything. So I had no interest in sport. And before I became mayor, I'd only been to one sporting event in my life. That's a cricket match at the Oval, and I fell asleep. So for me, it was only ever about regeneration, because that area of the East End, after the docks closed in the 60s, no government put any money in. They just assumed the people there would travel somewhere else to get work. And it's incredibly run down. It's the most polluted place in southern England. Now, all that soil's gone. We've got a park. We've got some great sport facilities. We've got an Olympic village. But we've also got the transport infrastructure.
This massive regeneration hasn't gone without casualties. We've just spent a couple of days, actually, in Carpenter's Estate, and we met so many people who have lived there for decades. In fact, there was one woman, Mary Finch, who's been there for 42 years, and she says she's heartbroken because her lovely, safe community is being torn apart. They're all being moved away from there. What would you say to her and people like her?
Well, no one should be being moved away. If people are moving, it's not because of the Olympics, because there's huge churn. In that area of Britain, you've most likely got people moving more frequently than anywhere else. Most likely the biggest site where immigrants arrive, and they're there for a few years and then they move on somewhere else.
Well,
it's not a wonderful old settled village down there.
Well, you know, so many of the people we met had been there for decades, and they were saying that it's not regeneration, it's actually gentrification.
Well, it is regeneration because, you've created, the Olympic Village, and about half the properties there will be affordable, not just market rents. You've got the best upgrade of the transport system that they've ever had.
There's been plenty of rhetoric, though, about affordable housing in East London, but the people we've met said they could never afford to live in these new high-rise apartments that are being built there.
But there's a separate problem here. This is Mrs. Thatcher, 30 years ago, stopped building council housing. To his shame, Tony Blair carried on that ban on council housing, and therefore we've now got a huge housing crisis. And that's not related to the Olympics. We should have been building 50,000 homes a year in London. We've been building about 16, and almost all of that has been private sector.
Part of the Olympic Village has been sold to a Qatari company. Would you have approved something like this as mayor?
It would have been. If I'd been mayor over this last 4 years, the priorities would have been a different. There would have been more of a preponderance of building homes for rent. I might quite happily have done a deal with the Qataris, but it would have been on, I suspect, quite different terms. London's elected a mayor who's very much a free marketeer.
Well, given the fact that 32,000 people are waiting for housing in Newham, wouldn't it have just been to their benefit to give it to those people?
Well, in one sense, the answer to that is no. You want a mixed community, and to get the balance right, gentrification is a bad thing if all that happens is poor people are moved out in here and rich people move in. But a better mix of community in which you've got a balance between working class and middle class people is pretty essential if you want local schools to work and job opportunities to arrive.
If we look at the intellectual property of the Games, we've spoken to a number of architects who have designed for these Olympic Games, but they can't submit their designs to international awards. I mean, because of the intellectual property that they're bound by, doesn't that disadvantage them?
If I was still mayor, I'd mostly say to Jack Rogg, it's time for you to loosen up a lot of the rules and regulations. Jack Rogg himself recently has said he worried about sponsorship by McDonald's and Coca-Cola when we're heading for a world obesity crisis. I think my advice to the IOC would be say, go for a slightly scaled down Games and reduce the level of sponsorship there. because I think it to a degree degrades the whole idea of what the Olympics is.
Can the UK really afford this, given you're in the grip of a recession?
Oh, God, it would be a disaster if we hadn't done this. I mean, London has... I mean, the British economy has basically gone back into a double-dip recession, but not in London, because we've still got the work and income being generated by the Olympic Games, the Shard, the transport upgrades that went around all this. Anywhere else, it would be a new town. But it's been worth every penny, because without that, that level of investment by government, London would have been deep in recession.
Well, you narrowly lost the mayoral election to Boris Johnson in May. In fact, very narrowly. Mm. That must have hurt.
Well, it's a poisonous campaign. But then, you know, I've been in politics 40 years. Nixon got elected. Berlusconi gets elected. Even Hitler got elected. Elections don't automatically choose the best person.
And, you know, did it hurt? I mean, the way you talk about what you would have done, it
seems... Oh, no, I mean, every day. I mean, I've been leader of the GLC for 5 years, an MP for 14, mayor for 8. I mean, except for those handful of people who've been prime minister or chancellor, I mean, almost no one in British politics has had such a good innings. It would have been nice to, you know, have another couple of terms or to be prime minister, all those things, but I've achieved a lot. I'm still going to be doing a lot because I'm still active in the Labour Party.
Have you retired now?
I won't run another election, but I'll still be campaigning around issues. I've just been writing an article about the need to build 50,000 homes here in London.
And how would you like to be remembered?
I don't care. I'm not worried about monuments. I mean, it's a question of what you achieve when you hold power. And I think my record on that has been quite good, actually, compared with most others.
And the association you have to the Olympics, is that something you're proud of?
I'm delighted we got that legacy, but I still have no interest in sport, really. Mm-hmm. I shall go to the opening ceremony because I should, but the rest I'll just watch the highlights on TV. I'll be doing my neighbour's garden.
Thanks. Thank you.
Former Mayor Ken Livingstone, known by his political enemies as Red Ken. With more time on his hands now, he says he's rereading Karl Marx and doing plenty of gardening. You can see that interview in full and read more on all tonight's stories on our website. Plus, tell us what you think of the Games and whether it will be good for London. That's at sbs.com.au/dateline. After the break, a group of athletes from Africa, a small town in Suffolk, and a whole lot of heartwarming Olympic spirit.
When the idea was hatched for Bury St Edmunds to host the Rwandan Olympic team, no one imagined the whole town would embrace their visitors.
It's amazing how you have warmth here, and we feel at home, I must say.